Good morning and welcome to this workshop. I was just noting that is the first time we have so many faculty members participating on various topics. We have eight of them, so let me very quickly introduce them to you and call them up on the dais. I am Deepak Phatak. I am the principal investigator of the T10KT project under which we conduct these workshops. This is Professor Viren Sethi, who many months ago finally agreed to coordinate this workshop. I will read out the names of other faculty colleagues who are participating in this workshop from their side. Professor Parsarthi, may I request you to come up, please? Professor Narayan from HSS, he is not here. Professor Munish Chandel, CSE, he is also not here. Professor Harish Fuleria, Professor Nikhil Kothurkar. Professor Nikhil Kothurkar is from Amruta University, our partner institution in this workshop. Professor Maya Mahajan from Amruta, she is also coming out. And Professor Ranjan Panda from HSS, please come up. Professor Kannan, my colleague and co-PI, is here. May I request Professor Kannan to join us on the dais, please? Professor Nikhil is a co-faculty member in this course. Professor Kannan Naudgalya, like me, is one of the organizers. He is the co-PI. He is also the coordinator for all national mission projects going on in IIT Bombay. So he has been a strong support of all the activities that we do here. I am going to share my thoughts on the massive open online courses and the turmoil that these courses are causing in the conventional education system. I hope most of you have heard about these massive open online courses at least. Some of you might already have done some courses. So let me tell you, this phenomena started just about 3 years ago and it is engulfing the educational world by storm. Before I talk about the MOOCs and their proliferation, I would like to set the context in which the current educational system works. We are all familiar with the need for holistic education. The holistic education requires that we build knowledge without silos. Sadly, in our professional courses, this does not happen today. We, in fact, specialize in building silos. Originally, we had electrical engineering, mechanical engineering, civil engineering. Then came the metallurgical engineering and chemical engineering. And then came a whole lot of other names. Now, these silos were important because you had to deal with the growing body of knowledge in each of these fields. However, in the process, we have convinced ourselves and our students that they need to understand just the silo in which they get a certificate at the end. So either somebody is a mechanical engineer, somebody is a computer engineer, somebody is an electrical engineer. And in the process, the holistic knowledge which is required to solve modern problems is somehow missing. A computer scientist, for example, genuinely believes that he or she need not know anything about mechanical engineering, which is a very sad part of life. I do not know whether in your own colleges you face a similar situation where the students studying a particular branch almost exclusively study topics of that branch and do not pay attention to the other courses. Surely in our engineering curriculum, there are common engineering courses in the first year at least, but how many students take those common engineering courses seriously? There are courses in humanities which are obligatory in the first year. How many of our students take those courses seriously? This is an important question because this precludes the possibility of our students getting a holistic education. Worse, we teachers also have come to believe that the silos is how we have to teach them. There is another aspect of holistic education which is completely missing. Strictly speaking, this should start with school education and should continue in the college education. And this relates to human values and social disciplines. Sadly, this is not part of a syllabus. And both our students and us teachers will not pay attention to something unless it is scheduled to be asked in an examination. I'll give you a simple example. India is probably the only country in which people regularly ignore a red traffic signal. You would have seen that? Okay. Imagine if one mark was to be deducted every time a student crossed the red signal. Would students do that? So it is not part of the syllabus. It is supposed to be, in general, the upbringing both in the school by teachers and by parents. Sadly, that is not happening. And as a result, we get a large number of students in our colleges who are not well-versed with fundamental adherence to values and social discipline. I do not know what is the solution to this, but holistic education is the first thing that gets sacrificed in our system today. We also need to have quality among scale and diversity. You are all familiar with our scale problems. How many students in engineering colleges? Any idea? 1.25 million students take admission to engineering colleges every year. This number has plateaued. It increased slightly and then it plateaued. The number of engineering colleges are increasing, but the total number of students in India taking engineering courses has stabilized. As a result, you will find many engineering colleges have to go without students today. That will happen because the number is static. In general, in the entire higher education sector in the country, the total number of students studying various courses, arts, commerce, law, whatever, three-year course, four-year course, the total number is roughly 2 to 2.5 crores. This is woefully short as compared to most other countries because our gross enrollment ratio is very low. In general, in most of the developed countries, the gross enrollment ratio is of the order of 60 to 80%. Our ratio is about 22%. We expect to increase it to 30%. And by that, we expect that by 2020, we would have about 3 crore plus students studying in higher education. Is that adequate? That is most certainly not adequate because more and more aspiring Indians are wanting to get better education. So here is another statistics. The number of Indians who are 14 years or younger, 14 years means what? They are all school going, 0 to 14. So 5 years, 6 years, 7 years, 8 years, 9 years, 14 years. Only after they finish their schooling, they will come to our place. Such number is 373 million. We have the largest number of prospective students in the world, larger than even China. Is it not our combined responsibility to provide good quality higher education to as many of them as come out and desire to do better education? There is a problem additionally in our country that the vocational training or vocational education is not made part of the normal education. It is considered a separate stream. That has caused a lot of problem. In most of the Western countries, when students study their schools, they automatically enroll and learn about some skills of their own. In our country, we don't do that. Sadly, the skills are learned by students who do either science or engineering subjects later because they have to do something with their hands. And that is where they learn a few things. But that is a larger challenge. It is in this context that I would like you to contemplate on what is the desire of an individual learner. You were all students, right? So you can imagine yourselves. When I put myself in 1964, when I joined engineering college as a student, majority of the students in my class wanted to get a good job at the end of the degree, a satisfactory growth path in the professional profile that they would join, and to lead a happy life. Would you agree that even today, most of the aspirations of the students would be built around this? They therefore wish to study something which will get them good opportunities for livelihood. It so happens that the perception in the society is that if you do an engineering degree, you have a better chance of getting livelihood. And therefore, students join engineering. You already know the problems with the science education. Most top performing students are not joining science streams, which is a very sad part because fundamentally, no good engineering can be constructed, no innovation in engineering can happen without a solid foundation of science and maths. We do try to teach science and maths in our courses, in engineering courses. However, as I mentioned, these are not considered important courses. What is considered important is only what you study in your third year and fourth year and the specialized topic. But if this is the desire of an individual learner, that teach me something which will help me get a livelihood, I come as a unique person. My learning habits are different. My learning style is different. My learning ability is different. Does the system cater to such a difference in learning abilities? No. So what is the response of our system? Our system says, we run a course called BE Electrical Engineering or BE Civil Engineering, or we run a course called BCom. It's a three-year course. You have to do these subjects. You have to study them. The subjects are semester long or year long. No choice. Are Baba, I can finish that course in 3 months. No, you can't. You have to study for one full semester. You have to give the exam only at the end of that course. And what kind of exams do we conduct? Consider the following. You all would have seen the question papers in your colleges, in the university. In majority of colleges, luckily not all, but in majority of colleges, the nature of the question papers is as follows. On the top, you will have a line which says, solve any 6 out of 10 questions. Agreed? Okay. Then there will be this or that or that or that. But the nature of the questions, question 1 will say, explain something. Question 2 will say, describe something. Question 3 will say, write short notes on. None of the answers require our students to think at all. They have to reproduce from whatever they have read from the books. And yet, year after year after year, we keep asking this. True, there are some problems. Somewhere, question 4B, there will be some problem which you will have to solve or something. Is this something new? No. By the way, this happened exactly in 1964 when I joined engineering college. I didn't know this pattern. First year I studied the entire syllabus, but I figured out that every question paper had this choice. So in the second year I studied only 60% of the syllabus and I could still score 85% marks. Then in the third year I discovered something new. Many questions were repeated. You agree? That happens even now. Then I could predict that which questions are likely to be repeated and further reduce the amount of study that I had to do. As a result, I had filled time in 5 years. Those days, this was a 5-year course. Only when I came to IIT Bombay and I faced my first question paper, I was looking at solve any 6 out of 10 or something, nothing of that sort. No describe, no explain. Problem 1, problem 2, problem 3, problem 4, problem 5, paper ends. It was an open book exam. I had carried 6 books. It was completely useless because no book or no solved problem in the book had any relevance to the problem that was asked. In IIT Bombay, we pride ourselves in saying that not a single question is repeated in our exams. The amount of effort it takes is enormous. In fact, I remember many years ago in a data processing course, in a re-exam, I had actually given a variation of a problem which I had asked 2 years earlier. And my colleague, Professor Sarda, looked at that paper. He was the invigilator. He says, Phatak, you are becoming lazy. This is not permitted in IIT. How many of us in the conventional university system follow this myth? Unfortunately, not all of you are interested with setting up question papers. You have also the system of affiliation. except some universities which are autonomous institutions who will be setting up their own question papers and so on, they probably follow the style which IITs and NITs follow. But almost all other colleges, which are affiliated colleges, are required to go by the process that is set by the university. What is that process? I teach my course to these 50 students, but their exam papers are set by someone else, and they are evaluated by still someone else. Tell me why these students should listen to me at all. They know fully well that I have absolutely zero contribution to their grades. So what they will do? They will attend coaching classes or some what they call guidebooks. I have heard of Navneet and such names at some places. And we all take it for granted that this is okay. Are we fighting it? Are we arguing about it? This has happened because of the system of affiliation of colleges to the universities, where we have abrogated our right as teacher to set questions, to evaluate people and to grade them. The IIT system still retains that entire autonomy of a teacher, but most other colleges do not. Do you know which are the countries in the world which follow this system of affiliated colleges? That is, colleges which are affiliated to a single university, where university decides the syllabus and university sets the question paper. My friend Professor Uday Desai, director of IIT Hyderabad, who is on the AICT review committee, told me this startling fact. There are exactly four countries in the world which follow this system of affiliation: India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. These are the countries which had the legacy of the British system. The British people are much wiser. They understood that this is nonsense and they changed it immediately. They do not have this notion of affiliated college. Each college is an independent institution. In the United States, each university, they call it a university. A university might have a school of something or college of something, but that is fiercely independent. A teacher who teaches sets the question paper. Now, this system is actually a must. There is an argument that we do not have many teachers who are well trained in that particular topic. So will they be able to do this? It's a chicken and egg story. If you never give me a responsibility, I will never live up to that. When I joined here as a teacher, I had not fallen from the sky. I also came from an institution such as yours. But I learned the hard way, learning from my seniors, my colleagues and others. It is entirely possible to do so. The AICT review committee, incidentally, is recommending that this system of affiliation should be completely stopped in 10 years. That every college must become an autonomous academic entity. And that the teachers in that college must work as if they are completely independent. So the autonomy of teachers is likely to be restored soon. Of course, we don't know. The parliament might say no, whatever. But that is the general direction in which things are moving. And let me also tell you why this direction. This direction comes about because of variety of technological innovations that have been happening around the world in order to help educational process. Let me very briefly tell you about the educational technology. This is not a comprehensive discussion, only a few elements of technology with which we are familiar in IIT Bombay is what I am describing. There are many innovations. These are the clicker devices that we designed many years ago. They are called the class response system. Originally, when we wanted to do this clicker, those of you who have seen Kaun Banega Karodpati would remember that Amitabh Bachchan uses this to take an audience poll. So audience quickly say A, B, C, D or something, and the poll is displayed. The results of the poll are displayed. I thought it would be very useful if I could use these devices in a classroom to conduct a quiz quickly, so that in 1 minute if I get to know how many people have understood a concept or not, it helps me, because if 80% of my students have not understood a particular concept, then I can construct an additional example and immediately correct their thinking. Normally what happens is that I will conduct a test or something 2 weeks or 3 weeks later. In that test, suppose all the students flunk that particular question, only then I know that they have not understood this. It is too late. The students have forgotten that. So we said we will start doing it. My colleague, Professor Kannan, who has been conducting a flipped classroom for years, uses them regularly. So let me just mention what a flipped classroom is. In the normal classroom, I give lectures in the class, and students are expected to do homework at home. So in the course specification, we always say that 3 to 5 hours per week of work students will have to do for every course. In a flipped classroom, I keep pre-recorded lectures on the server, and the students are supposed to see those lectures, view those lectures, and come to the classroom only for discussions. We have proven by formal methods, Professor Sridhar Iyer and Sahana Murthy have actually conducted experiments, controlled experiments, wherein it was found that in a flipped classroom, the engagement of the students for the subject increases up to 80% from somewhere between 40 to 50%. And that is because in the classroom, they don't have to listen to a lecture. They have to actually solve problems. They have to discuss problems amongst their peers. And they have to make presentations. And the entire hour is free because I don't have to waste time in giving lectures. The lectures are already pre-recorded. Professor Kannan, when he started this, he found that many students were not viewing the lectures at home. They're just coming like that. So he introduced this concept of conducting a quiz. The moment students appear in the class, the first quiz is conducted, which tries to find out whether students have viewed that lecture or not. That's all. There's nothing complicated question. But you know how the students behave. Even if there is half a mark associated with an activity, they will work towards it. So Professor Kannan's experience is that students started looking at all the lectures properly and came to the classroom well prepared. This improves the engagement of the students. Here is an Android tablet with a small experimental board. You are not people from electronics, but you might know that there is an Arduino board, which is an experimental open source design, which is available for $35 to $40, and you can construct variety of experiments using it. I have chosen to demonstrate this because this has a board which is designed by Professor Kannan's team called Anuduino. Anu is atom. So a small version of the Arduino. And this small version, along with a temperature sensor which is put on top of this, and the USB cable, costs somewhere around 100 rupees only. That means such a simple experiment can be done connecting it to any Android tablet. We are showing it on Akash tablet. Why I show this is, consider your environmental studies and the kind of sensors that you would like to demonstrate to people. Conventional experiments are costly and the sensors themselves are costly. But if it is possible for every individual student to attach n number of sensors here and do the kind of sensing, then it is possible to collect the data. Most of the functionality of data analysis is done through software. So you can use, for example, the Scilab, which is the equivalent of MATLAB, and do tremendous amount of statistical computations and analysis of data using this. His team again has put Scilab running on Android. It also runs on Linux, of course. These are the tools which are not known very well in our engineering colleges. How many of you are familiar with MATLAB? Many. And how many of you use Scilab? 1, 2, 3. Okay. We in IIT Bombay follow a simple rule. If you need a costly software product, then you must purchase the license, whatever be the cost. If you can't afford the cost, or if you can do with close to similar functionality, use a corresponding open source software. Unfortunately, that is not practiced in most of our colleges. I would urge you to go back and contemplate on this important issue. Any software that you use, any software, doesn't matter whether it is Windows or whatever, if you need a proprietary software, you must purchase license for that software. If you have an unlicensed software on your machine, it's a criminal activity amounting to theft. And if we teachers do not counter this, then we are a party to the theft. And more important, we are giving a message to our students that this is okay. I would urge you to go back and consider this and not permit this kind of thing. Fortunately, for much of the functionality that we require in science and engineering, there's a plethora of open source tools. Plethora of open source tools. Only thing is, they are not as easy to use as some commercial products are. So instead of spending time in learning those and using them, we find it easier to copy and load and install some proprietary software without paying for it. But if you consider that that's a criminal activity, perhaps you will stop and prevent that from happening. Here is an affordable netbook device, which again Professor Kannan's team has designed. Many people wanted a keyboard because people want to input either their answers or whatever. So a virtual keyboard is not found very useful on a tablet. So he designed this. This is of course costlier than Akash tablet. It cost us 5,000 rupees plus taxes. It's about 5,600 rupees. Still, it is the cheapest technology as far as a laptop is concerned. So it runs Linux completely. And in fact, in our CS101 course, where about 400, 500 students are there, there are many students who do not have their own laptops. We found out that there were about 50 or so who did not have their laptop. These 50 people were given these devices. And they are able to run C, C++ programs comfortably. You are all familiar with the T10KT project, so I will not spend much time. We have more than 300 remote centers. Our idea is to create about 500 remote centers. Because these remote centers act as aggregation points where many teachers from colleges around that place can come and attend this. Here is a coordinator's workshop like this. Okay, this had perhaps larger number of people because this was, I think, on computer programming or something. That's a more popular topic. So we had about 270 people or something like that. When you go back and conduct this workshop in your own remote center, you will have a situation like this. These teachers will assemble at your remote center and you will be coordinating that workshop at there. As you know, the methodology is that our faculty members associated with the course will deliver interactive lectures in the morning session typically, and in the afternoon, the labs and tutorials, etc., are to be conducted locally by these 35-40 teachers under your supervision. Now, here are a couple of things that I would like to mention. When I say under your supervision, they would expect that the labs and tutorials are conducted with the same rigor that they would have been conducted had they come to IIT Bombay. This is an important reason why we spend enormous amount of money to conduct the coordinator's workshop, which is face to face. By bringing all of you here, the idea is not only to tell you about the subject and the topic, most of you would already know it, but the idea is to convey to you the rigor with which we conduct anything that we do. And we would like you to conduct things with the same rigor when you go back in your college. Professor Viren Sethi will not be available in the afternoon session there. They would expect each one of you to act like Viren Sethi. So you are the entire personalization of the faculty member here who is conducting this. And that puts an onerous responsibility on each one of you. That means that each one of you will have to actually ensure that those 30, 40 teachers who come there for attending the workshop do things as rigorously as they would have been done in IIT. We have had, of course, umpteen advantages of this model. One, it could scale up. We first started with about training 1,000 teachers. Then we decided to run a T10KT program, 10,000 teachers at a time. That is a nomenclature. We never had 10,000 teachers, but we have anywhere between 5,000 to 8,000 teachers in any course. Please note that nowhere in the world there is a program of this scale which trains teachers 5,000 to 8,000. There are some added advantages. This particular thing is, I think, from Kerala. You will see a lot of lady teachers here. You can see them. There are, in fact, a few men who are sitting shyly at the end. We have consistently got emails from these lady teachers at various remote centers thanking us for conducting these workshops at their own place. They often say that we could never have left our families and children for 2 weeks to come to IIT Bombay to do this course. We can do this only because it is in our own place. So this is a byproduct, it's not intended. We don't, by the way, distinguish between men and women as far as the teachers are concerned. They are all teachers, and we believe that these teachers must benefit so that they are able to actually conduct the courses for students in a fashion which is similar to what we do in IIT system or in any one of the better systems. Here is another technology which again Professor Kannan's team has perfected called spoken tutorials. These spoken tutorials are 10-minute video recorded lectures. But there is hardly any video, there is no teacher's face there. There are slides and there is spoken material. So 10-minute spoken tutorial is actually a very low payload system. It does not have many moving things and so on, although you can use that as well. He has created a series of such tutorials on different topics connected with open source software. So variety of open source software, there are such spoken tutorials. And what he additionally does is his team first prepares a spoken tutorial in English. The entire voice is transcribed and the transcription is actually aligned to the timing, what time you speak, which sentence and so on. Then this transcription is translated into one and more of Indian languages, Hindi, Marathi, Telugu and so on. And this translated transcription is now dubbed on top of that original video. This method has been perfected like a military machine and it is not very costly. As a result, he has a series of such tutorials in multiple Indian languages. And these are all released in open source, as has been our contention right from the beginning. We believe that any knowledge that is created through public funding must be released in open source under Creative Commons license. So that is what we do. That means these tutorials can be downloaded by you, can be told to the students to use them. They can be modified if they wish. They are absolutely free material that is available. This is a workshop being conducted on how to use spoken tutorials. It's a 2-hour workshop because these are all self-learning tutorials. You don't require a teacher or something. But how to use spoken tutorials, there is a workshop. And while conducting such workshops, there is often a help from IIT Bombay. So here is one of the team members of Professor Kannan who is explaining certain questions that are being raised. How many of you have heard of virtual labs? Well, several people. It's an extremely important initiative of the national mission, which permits two things. One, the laboratories, the lab experiments which are set up in these institutions can be used remotely. And these are not merely simulations. They're actually costly equipment on which you can do experimentation from remote. So you can actually control these experiments. There are a variety of things, starting with simulation, starting with animation, starting with variety of things, and the actual experiment. This virtual labs is a very, very important initiative. Many institutions are participating. Again, all these virtual labs are released in open source. They can be accessed by anybody. So those of you who are interested can actually go to this site, find out which are the virtual labs which are relevant to environmental studies, and start using them. This is an extremely important initiative from the school education side. It's called NROER, that is National Repository for Open Educational Resources. So NCERT, which is essentially an agency responsible for doing research and development for school education, have created these open source resources. And they have a variety of resources. They have videos, they have audios, they have animations, they have interactive lessons, all kinds of things. And all of these are released in open source. In fact, I have been arguing with the school department to release all their books in open source. They have incidentally converted their CBSE books into EPUB 3 compliant version. A partner institution of ours actually did a lot of work in there, Shastra University. And these EPUB 3 compliant books, by 31st March, almost all CBSE books will be available in EPUB 3 compliant. EPUB 3 incidentally has been the standard that has been adopted by India for all such books. EPUB 3 is nothing but a container specification. So it has not just a text or something, but it contains the entire book with index and so on. So that is what is being made available here through NAR. It is in this overall context that I would like to talk about the massive open online courses. As I said, this phenomena started about 3 years ago. Online learning, by the way, is nothing new. Many of you would have heard of intelligent tutoring system, e-learning systems. They have been there for ages, for at least 30 years. Ever since the computers came, people could put some learning material on the machine and you could use that learning material either to give online test quizzes or something or look at the material. All the open source contents are viewed by people on the machine itself. But a massive open online course is something different. It is not just arbitrary set of content. It is actually a course as is delivered in a college. So consider, for example, I wish to deliver a course in computer programming. Now, computer programming course has a book on computer programming, lots of programs and so on. But how do I conduct the course when I teach it? Every week, I will teach them some lectures. Every week, I will give them some assignments. They will have to give some quiz at the end of the week. And they will have to submit actual programs. Next week, similar thing. Third week, similar thing. There might be some review or something. And during these classes, there is a perpetual discussion, arguments, questions asked. That is how people learn. People don't learn merely because they have access to high quality content. I have an interesting theory that if access to the highest quality content could guarantee that people could become very knowledgeable, then all the librarians in this world would have been the most knowledgeable people. Because they have access to the maximum best quality. There is no evidence of that. So access to knowledge does not convert you into a knowledgeable person. You become knowledgeable by applying your mind, by solving some problems, by discussing issues, by understanding that concept and applying that concept to solve problems and so on. Now that happens in a course. So MOOC is not just the content. MOOC is actually conducting a course week by week by week, 4 week course, 8 week course, etc. And three companies started this in US, Coursera, Udacity and EDX. There are several other companies now in Europe, in England. In India, we have several such initiatives here. In the MOOCs, everything is online. I was asked in 2013 to comment on the suitability of MOOCs for engineering education. So that in that invited paper, I have suggested that complete online may not be a suitable thing, and I have suggested a blended MOOCs approach. In a blended MOOCs approach, suppose I am a student in Coimbatore and I am studying, let's say, thermodynamics. Now, if thermodynamics is an online course which is offered by Professor Gaitonde of IIT Bombay, it's a MOOC course, then I have a choice of registering for that MOOCs course, provided my college in Coimbatore accepts the grade that I get on that MOOCs course as my grade. Because if that does not happen, I am not interested in doing that online course. Why would my college accept that grade? Because my college has a different way of doing things. So the method that I am suggesting is, if my Coimbatore college is an autonomous college, then I will ask that autonomous college the following. This is the syllabus that Professor Gaitonde follows while teaching thermodynamics. If this syllabus is okay with you, ask all your students to register for this course. In Coimbatore college, don't waste time in giving lectures. That is being taken care of by Professor Gaitonde's MOOCs course. Instead, run a flipped classroom and discuss hard problems with them, discuss difficult concepts with them. So do a flipped classroom. Additionally, give some assignments locally to individuals and groups of students in thermodynamics. Guide them and evaluate them. So let us say you get some marks for the local assignments and you get some marks from the MOOCs. Combination of these marks would correspond to a grade in that course in Coimbatore. Now this idea has been accepted by many universities and autonomous colleges, and IIT Bombay X, where we offer these MOOCs courses, will be offering such blended MOOCs courses from June onwards to many institutions which are willing to accept the grade for that subject for their students. These are the MOOCs from IIT Bombay X. Currently we have only a few courses. We are ready because we had offered these courses to the global learners in 2014, but we are waiting for the national launch of the Swayam portal. But when we found out that the Swayam portal launch is getting delayed, we decided to offer the IIT Bombay X. So these courses are currently running. Of course, we introduced these in between a semester, which is not a very good thing. So there are not too many students. There are about 10,000 registered students for one course, about 6,000 for the other course, and so on. But in June, July, when we coincide with the beginning of the next semester, we believe that a large number of students will benefit. NPTEL, the National Program on Technology Enabled Learning, which has created course contents for about 1,200 courses. All engineering courses, video lectures, 1 hour long, etc. are already. But now they are finding out that to convert a content into a course, which you have to run week by week, is some difficulty, and they are doing it. So NPTEL has started offering courses where they give certification against some fees, and this certification is done through supervised online examination. IIT Kanpur has an experiment which Professor Prabhakar has run. He runs a course called MOOC on MOOC. So a massive open online course on massive open online. So you want to know what is a MOOC, you do this course, you will learn everything about the MOOC. A similar experimental setup was done by our colleague, Professor Kameshwari, here in IIT Bombay, and she has used it for her own course in a flipped classroom, and she has also used it for a T10KT workshop on computer networks that she conducted. What we propose is, in IIT Bombay X, we will be incorporating features of the Bodhi tree, which is the name that she has given to that platform, and we'll be bringing it here. So you see now what is likely to happen. The students will certainly say that, look, if I can get the best course from the best teacher, why do I worry about your course and your degree? What is our response? Our response is simple. You are registered for this BE course in my college. You will not get a degree, you will not get marks unless you give exams as per this course. Agreed? Now imagine the following. The industry says that, look, I don't need your degree and marks. I can evaluate the knowledge of individuals directly through online tests. And I will shortlist them based on their knowledge and give them jobs. It has already started happening. My friend Mr. Ramdurai, when he was heading TCS, and they used to admit people as employees only those who are engineering graduates. He did an experiment and he employed 5,000 students with a BSc degree. And he proudly tells me that most of them, of course they were selected from amongst 5 lakh applicants, but most of them are turning out to be as good programmers as the engineering graduates were. That means talent exists universally. It's just a question of giving a portion. My friend Dr. Anand Deshpande in Persistent Systems in Pune did an online test for shortlisting people. And those were people who were engineering college degree holders or about to get their degree. And he found that several people were failing, but some people were passing on these online tests. Last month he did an experiment and he announced that anybody can take this test. You don't have to have a degree. But if you do well in this test, you will get an employment. And he has the first set of such employees who do not have a degree. Now imagine, if the society and the employers start figuring out the knowledge of the people and start saying that we don't care for a degree, what happens to us? What happens to our system? Please appreciate that the arrogance of the formal educational system, including that of IITs, is based on the fact that society and employers care for our degrees, that society and employers care for the marks that we give. The moment society and employers discover that they don't need degrees, they don't need marks, they can evaluate the knowledge of the people independently. And the moment learners discover that they don't have to pay costly tuition fees to learn something, they can learn through MOOCs, what will happen? Is this hypothetical? Well, friends, this is not hypothetical. When internet came, people said, oh, that is all hawa hai. In 5 years, internet changed things. When web came, people again said, web is okay. What has happened? Web has disrupted almost all commercial transactions that happen in the world today. It is well known that the next disruption by the web would be in education and in healthcare. Already personalized drug delivery is being attempted. A variety of things would happen here. One of the 14 grand challenges that National Academy of Engineers in the United States has listed, there are many, many items that they have listed. It will be interesting for you to look at that, by the way. It has solar energy, it has cheap drinking water, etc., etc. One of them is advancing personalized instructions. Personalized instructions is like intelligent tutoring system, but current intelligent tutoring systems work like this. If there are 100 students who take a course, and suppose 20 of them are performing very poorly, and let's say all of them have 30% marks. So the intelligent tutoring system will give additional material to these 20 people. However, exactly identical additional material is given to all 20. Because the decision is based only on their score. We know, for example, that out of these 20 people, each one has a different learning habit. Massive open online courses permit you to capture the interaction, and therefore you can determine the style in which individual person has learned. Who has seen the video first, who has seen the solved example first, who jumped directly to the quiz, everything is captured. So there is an opportunity of what we call a big data analytics, which will lead to personalized instructions in coming years. I am saying that the future holds these kind of possibilities for us. I am not trying to scare you, but I am trying to tell you that the best approach appears to me for our system is to adopt these technologies. Is to adopt these technologies and make them part of our system itself. That way we'll improve the learning, we'll improve our own learning, we'll actually make our system of teaching learning more effective. That's the only thesis that I had. I would read this line. We wrongly assume that our job as a teacher is to teach people a subject. That is nonsense. Students are capable of learning on their own. Okay, we act as guides, and therefore I believe that our main job is to encourage students, to mentor students, and to empower them. Make them think. If we can do that, that is nice. I would like you to take this message to the teachers who come at your place, that tell them that this is what they have to do. And then, of course, you have to teach that particular subject, because we have another stupid thing, I believe, that you must teach so many lectures per semester or something like that, right? You have such rules? In fact, you have some very funny rules. A lecturer must take so many classes, an assistant professor must take only so many, and a professor must take only so many. I wish such beautiful rules were there, because as a senior professor, then I won't have to teach at all. I have to slog as much as a young colleague of mine has to slog. So that is another mechanism. But anyway, I would strongly suggest that please pass on this message to the teachers who come under your charge, that tell them that their main job, in the humble opinion of an old teacher called Phatak, is to encourage, mentor, and empower the students who come to them. Thank you so much.